Good morning, good morning. We'd like everyone here to stand up. We're going to enter into worship today. We want to welcome you here to the Global Sphere Center. All of you join us by webcast today. We're going to say this is the day that the Lord has made. We choose to rejoice and be glad in it. So enter into worship. Let the Lord have your first and your best today.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Well, I'm getting up, shaking off the dust, and my eyes are beginning to see. Well, I could never win, cause I was listening to the voice of the enemy. But now I'm gonna talk back, and here's what I'm gonna say. Would you shut your mouth, hey? Never win, cause I was listening to the voice of the enemy. But now I'm gonna talk back, and here's what I'm gonna say. Well, just shut your mouth, you demons of darkness, you lying spirits of fear. Well, just shut your mouth, you spirits of doubt and distrust and disbelief and despair. Well, just shut your mouth, but I'm only gonna listen to the voice of the Lord this year. Would you shut your mouth? Okay, we're going to say right now, I'm not going to listen to the voice of the enemy. He never has anything good to say. He's only going to tell you that you can't, you won't, you're not able to, you're no good. Well, all those things might be true. It doesn't make any difference, but my Jesus can do all things through my weakness. So I don't want to tell the devil, just shut your mouth. I don't care if it's true what you're saying or not. Jesus overcomes all of my weaknesses. I'm not worthy, it's true. But Jesus has made me righteous in Him, all right? I can't do that. I can't pay the rent. I can't help myself in this situation. Well, maybe it's true. But through Christ, I can do all things. So, devil, just shut your mouth. Well, I'm getting up, shaking off the dust, and my eyes are beginning to see. Well, I could never win, because I was listening to the voice of the enemy. But I'm going to talk back, and here's what I'm going to say. Well, just shut your mouth. Oh, oh. Tried to take me down. Yeah, he wanted to see me drown. But I spoke back to him, said I'm not going in. Now I'm standing on a solid ground. I'm getting up, shaking off the dust, and my eyes are beginning to see. Well, I could never win, but I was listening to the voice of the enemy. But now I'm gonna talk back, and here's what I'm gonna say. Would you shut your mouth, you demons of darkness, you lying spirits of fear? Would you shut your mouth, you demons of doubt and distrust and disbelief and despair? Would you shut your mouth? Well, I'm only gonna listen to the voice of the Lord this year. Would you shut your mouth? Well, I'll get up, shake it off the dust in my eyes and begin to see. But I could never win, cause I was listening to the voice of the enemy. But now I'm gonna talk back, and here's what I'm gonna say. Would you shut your mouth?
trumpets sound, let the earth bow down, let the heavens cry out. Let the angels sing, let creation proclaim, let the people shout.
Glory and honor to him who has overcome the grave. Shout, Jesus reigns! He is
down, let the heavens cry out. Let the angels sing, let creation proclaim, let the people shout.
Glory and honor to him who has overcome the grave. For every generation sing, Jesus reigns.
His own, and Jerusalem.
Jerusalem his throne. Every nation come to know Jesus reigns. Jesus reigns. Jesus reigns. Jesus reigns. Him alone. Jesus reigns. There's no one above him. He reigns. Jesus reigns.
Every tribe, every tongue, every nation. So today for Israel, we say, let there be a cry in Israel. Let the nations arise in Israel this tabernacle time. Let there be praise in the nation of Israel. We say every tribe, every tongue will profess and proclaim that Jesus Christ reigns.
Glory and honor to him who has overcome. Glory and honor to him who has overcome. Glory and honor to him who has overcome the grave. Over sadness he reigns. Over sickness he reigns. Over hopelessness he reigns. Jesus reigns, Jesus reigns. Over poverty he reigns. Over darkness he reigns. Over death our God reigns. Jesus reigns, Jesus reigns. Over our people all his own.
Our God reigns. play something into this on that trumpet. Solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Here I am. I dare not trust the sweetest frame.
If you have a loved one that has cancer, I want you to lift your hands. Yeah, I want you to make your way right down here real fast, and I'll tell you why. The Lord will deliver even the one who's not clean by the cleanliness of your hands. But the Lord spoke to me this morning, and this is what it, yeah, make your way on down. Just spread out. The Lord spoke to me this morning, and He said, all those who have come standing in the gap for their loved ones, their friends, their family, the Lord said, I'm going to show them a miracle. Hey! Now lift up your hands if that's you. Lift it up. Now, as John sings back over us, and we stay in a place of worship, God reigns over cancer. God is not too big, and He has heard your cries this morning, and He has come down to do a miraculous work for the one who is not here. And the Lord said, by your faith, He will heal the one that's not here to receive healing today. Go ahead, John.
Over cancer, He reigns. It cannot stand in His presence. For the glory
you're crying out for. There is a new anointing for the one who stands in the gap. There is miracles. There is signs and wonders. What you thought that could not occur is occurring right now in Jesus' name. While we're in this place of worship, if you're joining us by webcast, stand up, lift up your hands. The Spirit of God is fixing to do something just for you. Go ahead, Leanne.
I see His love and mercy washing over all our sins. The people sing. Hosanna.
it's a testimony and a praise report that he wants to give.
So my mom has been dealing with cancer for about 2 years now, and she was diagnosed to be terminally ill last, I think, January. And she started going to Cancer Treatment Centers of America, and last Wednesday they told her that she is cancer-free. There is no more cancer in her body. And I know that this is a hard struggle for people that are not only going through it, but the family members around them. And I'm going to continue to pray for them, not because they need it, but because I know what it's like to go through that. And I'm going to continue to pray, and I'm going to pray for healing and restoration, not only for them, but for the family members that they're going through it. And I just continue to pray that over y'all.
Amen. Now give the Lord a praise. Give the Lord a praise, because we overcome the enemy by the blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony, and not loving our life unto death. Give the Lord a praise, because the Lord is ready to do something for you. For you. Today he reigns, and he's getting ready to do something for you.
John 7 says that the last great day of the feast, when Jesus said, "Let any man come to me who is thirsty and drink," in the Jewish, in the Hebrew, hey, that is Hoshana Rabbah. It means it is the great Hosanna. Today is that day. Today is the great Hosanna. Come to him and drink.
raise your hands. He's worthy. Lord, you're worthy. Lord, you're worthy of our praise today. We exalt you. We say that you'll have the position that's the highest. That's the most beautiful. That's the most honored. I want to ask your communion service to begin passing out the elements. Stay in this position as they lead us. And we loose the hallelujah. Earth to heaven, heaven to earth.
The Lord of hosts.
Holy Spirit, draw all men, draw all boys, women, children, girls. Draw them to your Son, Jesus Christ. Draw them to the Lamb that was slain from the foundations of the world. Draw them to that life-giving water. So as you take the body now, declare that you will be drawn to the life that is given in Christ Jesus. Father, we thank you for the blood, the power, the victory that was shed on our behalf. Father, we thank you for the life in the blood. We receive that life that was poured out for us today.
Oh, make way, make way. The King of Glory, the King of Glory is in this place. Make way, make way, make way, make way. The King of Glory, the King of Glory is in this place. Oh God, we love you. Oh God, we adore you. Oh God, we bow down before you. We bow down before you.
Oh God, we cast our crowns before you, and we bow down. We
has been singing about vision and seeing. The Lord says, this is a day I brought my people to a height. I brought them to a high place so their vision would be changed. This is an hour in which your faith becomes sight. The Lord says, for my people, this is their hour that faith will become sight. He says, put your hands on your eyes. Allow your spiritual eyes to receive new vision. The Lord says, I am causing you to see in dimensions you have yet to begin to see in. I'm causing you to believe for things you never expected you could ask or imagine. The Lord says, let your eyes be anointed, for this is the day that I am loosing my messengers of fire who will see that your faith becomes sight. He says, declare that today is my day that my faith becomes sight. Atmosphere. We want to pray for Israel today. Today is the International Day to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. So, Father, we do pray for the peace of Jerusalem today. As the nations have gathered in that place, we say, let there be a new outpouring of your Spirit. Let there be a new outpouring of your glory. That city would rise, Lord, even where it's being contested, that they would seek to divide and pull it apart. Father, we say, let a remnant, let a bride arise in Jerusalem. Let a bride arise in your promised covenant land. That there be a bride who's dressed brilliantly. Brilliantly, Lord. Father, we pray for that city today. We pray for your peace to be made manifest, that there'd be a hunger, that there'd be a desire to know you, to feel your rivers of water poured out in that place. So we lift up that chosen place, Lord, that you'd manifest your glory, your power, your presence there today. Father, we thank you that the nations come before you to give their praise. The nations assemble to worship. The nations assemble to honor you as the God above all gods, the one that's worthy, holy, just, righteous, the wonder-working God, able to do miracles, to give us vision, the God of the impossible, the God who is almighty. We worship you here today. We honor you. We say you be magnified. You be honored and adored. We have a group from the nations that's here today. We have a group from Taiwan. I want all the people from Taiwan, if you can quickly come up to the center here. All the delegation from Taiwan, if you want to come. And Lucy and Wendy, I know that you're getting ready to go to China and Taiwan. Come and be with them here in the middle. They've come here to be a part of a gathering at Gateway. And they said before they went to that gathering, they wanted to come here. They got up very early this morning after an international trip to join us. They wanted to be here, a part of this worship. So I want to honor those that have come from Taiwan, the team, Pastor Joe, and other leaders that are here. We say, let this be a day when the Spirit of God rises on you in a new way. We say, arise, arise and shine. We say that Taiwan will arise with a new glory, that Taiwan will arise with a new strength, that there'll be new praise, that there'll be new worship, that there'll be a new understanding of heaven touching earth and earth reaching back to heaven. We say, Taiwan, arise, arise, be filled and empowered in a new way. We say, let the glory of the Lord shine, let it be radiant upon you, that your lives will be changed, that your worship will be changed. We say, Taiwan, let this be a day in which your faith is made sight. And Lucy and Wendy going into China and Taiwan, we say, let the robe, I hear a yoke, it's a yoke of glory that the Lord is desiring to yoke you in a new way. So we say, be yoked in a new way as you go into minister, as to work. We say, be established so that the glory of the Lord will be with you and manifest in new ways. All the rest of you, raise your hands. Raise your hand. Whatever tribe, whatever tongue, whatever language it is that you speak, this is a day that the Lord is looking for your honor. He's looking for you to lift up that glory and honor to Him. So today, Father, we declare that this is a day we dedicate it to you, that you will receive all the honor, all the glory, all the authority, and all the power, for you alone are worthy. We say, be praised in this place. Be praised in every place that's connecting with us on the webcast. We say, let this be an hour in which your praise is glorious. As we continue to celebrate this tabernacle season, we say, Lord, manifest your glory. Manifest your glory and goodness in all the nations in Jesus' name.
Strategic in mind. You know, you're not just walking around on the earth, but God has purposed you, and you underestimate yourself tremendously. We all do that. And it's time for us to begin to rise up and say, you know, it might as well be me, right? It may as well be me, because God says, who will go for us and whom shall we send? I mean, God is talking with the Godhead and saying that. And Isaiah says, here am I, Lord, here am I, such as I am, send me. And I'm telling you, God, there is nothing, there are no boundaries. What Cheryl was saying this morning, God has made you a limitless propensity for goodness and greatness and godliness and miracles and hope. And listen, it's coming through you into the earth. He's not just pouring it out from some spout. He's pouring it down and through each one of you. And it's like, we got to align ourselves with His greatness and His purposes. And it's not pride to believe that God has said something that He's already said. It's just to step into a place of agreement, so that His kingdom can come on the earth and He can flow down through you, because you begin to expect Him to do amazing things. Just like Cheryl, you know, raising people from the dead. I mean, who does that, you know? But God's saying, I've chosen you to be a noble vessel of honor, and your spirit is unconstrained. Just like she said this morning, her spirit was so muscled up. It's like, let your spirit become greater than your physical body, because your spirit has the propensity to become much greater than your limited physical body. So I'm just releasing this over you today, and just obedience to the Lord. But I'm telling you, if you never believe that you were born for greatness, you'll never step into it. Do you understand? You've got to believe God, and you've got to step into agreement with His Word and say, okay, Lord, here am I. Send me. I will go for you. I will do. I'll lay hands on the sick. I'll listen to your voice, and I'll obey you, and I'll let you raise me up so I can raise you up. He wants to raise up a people that will raise Him up. And that is not prideful. That is not arrogant. That's just strategic. Very strategic. So, Lord, we thank you that you said this morning, you created us to be limitless. You created us, Lord God, to be and to do amazing things in the earth so that you might be glorified through every act, through every word, through every song, through every action, through every movement, God, that you can be expressed in the earth. And Lord, we just join with you in your purposes today.
Now I want each one of y'all to extend your hands to this group. You know, it's a great honor to have them in our house.
And it's a great honor to be in a house that many can come in and many can go out of. It's a great honor to see the nations come in and us have the opportunity to extend a hand of blessings to the nations. I want y'all to extend your hands to them. Stand up, extend your hands, and begin to pray in the Spirit over them. As I was laying hands on each one of them, the Lord spoke to me, and this is what He said. He said, I brought them here for my favor to become a shield around them. He said, I brought them here for the blessings of God to overtake them. He said, I brought them here for such a time as this. And He said, truly, I am anointing them. I am anointing them to come in, but I'm anointing them to send them out. And when I send them out, I will use them, and I will use them in a miraculous way. I will use them in a mighty way. I will use them to see your Goliaths fall, see your Hamans hung, see your Jezebels cast down. Yes, I will use them because I have anointed them for such a time as this. So, Lord, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, that we can be a part of what you're doing in each one of these people's lives. And, Lord, we thank you that today is a day that the Spirit of God is not only indwelling in them, but empowering them to arise and go forth. To arise and go forth and let their light shine. But, Lord, to use them to see blind eyes open, deaf ears hear, the miraculous occur, the withered hand extend, and yes, even life blown in where death has occurred. And Lord, we give you the glory, we give you the honor, and we give you the praise. Just give Him a shout this morning.
You were not made for chains, not made to be enslaved. You were not made to lean on the voice of your own reasoning. You were not made for sorrow, not made to fear tomorrow or regret the past. He's made you free at last. Take those chains off of your feet now. Take those chains off of your feet now. Take those chains off of your feet now. Take those chains off of your feet. 'Cause you were born to be limitless. You were born for so.
born for more. You were born for more. You were born to be unafraid. Neither height nor width nor depth can separate you now. Can separate you now. Oh. Sing that with me. You were not made for chains, not made to be enslaved. You were not made to lean on the voice of your own reasoning. And you were not made for sorrow, not made to fear tomorrow or regret the past. He's made you free at last. Oh. So take those chains off of your feet now. Take those chains off of your feet now. Take those chains off of your feet.
We thank you, Father, that you have made us, you fashioned us, you formed us in your likeness so that we would represent you here in the earth. We thank you that you created us, that you've made our boundaries, that you set them in good places. So today we receive that image, those extended boundaries, the limitless nature that we have through the gift of Christ Jesus, your Son, and your Spirit in us. We thank you for meeting us today, that we can be your sons and daughters. We bless you. And all God's people said, amen. 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 Thank you. You may be seated. I'm going to ask Leanne to stay up here 1 second. So we want to welcome all of you here today. We're excited that Chuck and the team have made it back from New Zealand, Australia, and Singapore. So we speak blessings to them, to James and Ann and Chad and Chuck and Rose and John and Cheryl and Raymond. Do I have all the team? Okay, I've got all the team. We want to keep them in your prayers as they've come back. They had an incredible trip. Chuck shared a little bit about that in the first service, so if you weren't here, you're going to want to watch that webcast replay. We've got a few things we want to make sure that you're very aware of this week. Starting on Tuesday, we're going to get back in our cycle of prayer. So Tuesday morning, 6 o'clock. Say Tuesday at 6 a.m. We're starting back again with corporate intercession. It'll be here in the tabernacle. Then Tuesday night at 6 p.m. Say Tuesday at 6 p.m. We're going to be celebrating Dancing with the Torah, the Simchat Torah. So that'll be Tuesday night that we're going to celebrate it here. Robert's going to lead us in a time of Dancing with the Scroll. Everyone's invited. Then on Wednesday at noon, we're going to get back in a rotation Wednesday at noon. Say Wednesday at noon. Chuck is going to be starting our new focus. It's a 52-day focus called Arise and Build Your Future. So it's going to be a 50-day focus. Chuck's going to kick that off Wednesday at noon. And so he wanted to make sure that a couple of great books that he's going to be working with on that prayer focus, one, the new book that he and Robert have, The Apostolic Church Arising. If you don't have this, it's an awesome book. We have it back in stock now. And two other books that he's going to be using a lot in that series are Robert's book, The Messianic Church Arising, and then the book that Chuck did, God's Unfolding Battle Plan. So those will be three key books. If you don't have those, you might want to stop at the bookstore or check online. But I have one other thing before we're going to ask Robert to come up, and I need Leanne's help to do this. We have a birthday that's going to happen tomorrow. So someone asked for a birthday wish, and when it's Keith Pierce, I say, that's great. So tomorrow it's Keith's birthday. So he asked for one thing, if Leanne would sing a cappella, Amazing Grace, for him.
You know, and I want everybody to stand up, not just because it's my birthday, but I really want to say something. Right. Brian and I were talking and about it being my birthday, and I said, you know, if I could have one wish today, it was to hear Leanne sing Amazing Grace a cappella. And I tell you why. If I can say anything to y'all and release anything to y'all regarding my birthday, it is the power of His grace, because I would not be standing here, neither would you, without the power of the grace of an awesome God. And that grace has saved us, that grace has kept us, and that grace brings us to where, thank you very much. Oh, great increase on your head. But here's the deal, as she's singing it, receive it as a blessing, and let's extend it to a blessing to others.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Was grace that taught
just begin
my
to join in with
heart
her
to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How that grace. peace appear. The hour I first believed, and through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already.
Now just give the Lord a praise.
And we'll say happy birthday, Keith Pierce. Amen. All right, with that, we want to welcome Robert Heidler to begin teaching us more on understanding the new Hebraic year. Please join me in welcoming Robert.
Thank you, Brian. Wow. Wow. Well, I want to pick up right where Leanne left off in what she was sharing and singing. Because God wants you to know that you were made to be limitless. You were made to be so much more than you have ever imagined. The trouble is, most of us have believed the lies of the enemy that have held us in bondage, but God wants to set you free. The truth will set you free. And you will do things that you never imagined that you could have done. Tell your neighbor, God has so much more for you. But the trouble is, how do we get from here to there? How do we get from where we are now to where we enter in to the call and the destiny that you were created for? And that's what I want to speak about today. So the message today is the year of the Vav, connecting your past with your future. Tell your neighbor, you've got a future. You know, we've just begun the Hebrew year 5776. And if you were with us at our Head of the Year conference where we talk about the prophetic meaning of the year, you'll remember that in Hebrew, this year is represented by the letter Vav, which looks like this. Vav is the sixth letter of the Hebrew alphabet. It's also the Hebrew number 6. And Hebrew letters were originally pictures. They each have a meaning. Vav was a picture of a connecting pin. Vav joins things together. And so the year of Vav is the year when connections are very important. Now, see, Hebrew does not have any word for and. So to join two words together, instead of having an and, they just add a Vav to the second word. And that forms a connection. Vav connects some interesting things. If you were with us ahead of the year, we talked about some of the things that Vav connects. One writer said, Vav connects one word to another, one thought to another, one world to another. Vav also connects the past and the future. In Hebrew, if you add a Vav to a future tense verb, you can transform it into a past tense. If you add a Vav to a past tense verb, you can bring it into the future. So this is a year when God wants to connect your past to your future. And see, God wants you to know you have a glorious past. See, you did not just begin 30 or 40 or 50 or 60 years ago when you were born. There was more going on concerning you before you got here. The Bible tells us that God planned for you and prepared for you before the foundation of the earth. Let's look at some verses. Ephesians 1:4, God chose you. Tell your neighbor, you were chosen. God chose you before the foundation of the world. Ephesians 1:5, before the world was created, God loved you. Tell your neighbor, you've been loved. He loved you and he chose a destiny for your life. You know, Jeremiah 29:11 talks about God has a good plan for your life. God wants you to know that plan was not an afterthought. That plan began before the universe was formed. Psalm 139:16, all your days were written in his book before one of them came to be. Ephesians 2:10, God prepared good works in advance for you to do. That means when God created you, when God brought you forth, it was on assignment. God had things planned for you to accomplish. That means you have a call of God on your life. You're here for a purpose. You did not just happen. You're not just an accident. You were planned. See, you were a thought in the mind of God before the universe came into being. That is your past. But if you belong to Jesus, you also have a glorious future. And I'm not just talking about heaven, although that will be glorious. But see, God has a plan for your life right here on earth. Jeremiah 29:11, his plan for you is to prosper you and not to harm you, to give you hope and a future. Tell your neighbor, you have a future. Romans 8:28 says, in every circumstance of life, God is working everything together to fulfill his good and perfect plan for you. Jeremiah 1:5, before he formed you, he knew you. Before you were born, he set you apart for a unique purpose. Ephesians 1:11, before creation, God designed a unique and perfect destiny for you to fulfill. And God not only created you for a purpose, but God has been giving promises and speaking prophecies over your life. He's given you all the promises of Scripture. Somebody said there's 7,000 promises in the Bible. 2 Corinthians says every promise there is for you if you are in Christ. God spoke to your parents and your grandparents about you before you were born. Some people didn't realize that. Now, some of your parents weren't listening. But I honestly believe he speaks to every parent about the destiny of their children. And then he spoke to you. God has placed things in your heart about your call and your destiny. You might not understand all of it yet, but God planted things within you. And so in ways that you're not even aware of, God is working to direct you into the fullness of the purpose you were created for. So you have a glorious past, and you have a glorious future. But it's the in-between time that can get a little dicey. Because you also have an enemy. And Satan and his forces will war to try to prevent you from entering the future that God has for you. And so between your past and your future, there is a battle to be fought. Now in the past, you have the promises of God, you have the prophetic words of God. In the future, there is a fulfillment. God wants to bring you into a place where you fulfill your destiny in the earth. But how do you connect them? How do you make it from the promises of the past through the warfare of the present into the glorious future that God has promised? Well, this morning I want to look at three examples of how to connect the past into the future. One is Jacob. Second is a king named Josiah. And the third is Jesus. We have three J's this morning. Let's look at Jacob first. See, Jacob had a call of God on his life. He was chosen by God to be the progenitor of the nation of Israel. Not only that, he was the ancestor of the Messiah. That's quite a destiny. He was a man of destiny before he was born. God spoke to his mother, Rebekah, that Jacob would be the child of promise. But then Rebekah went into labor. And Jacob's brother Esau won the race down the birth canal. Jacob was 1 minute late. He came out holding on to Esau's ankle, saying, wait a minute, let me out. And see, in that society, whichever child was born first, even if it was just by 30 seconds, received the blessing and the birthright. And Jacob was born second. And so Jacob had wonderful promises over his life, but in reality, he was the second born, without rank or privilege. And I am sure that Jacob lived with regret. I mean, you know, we were twins. It could have been either one of us coming out first. I'm sure he said to himself, if only I had been born first, I would have the blessing. I am sure Satan talked to Jacob, told him, you know, that one event in your past will block your destiny. See, that's what Satan tells a lot of people. Satan will point to something in your life and say, well, you really could have made it if it weren't for that. Just that one circumstance in your life, in your past, will block your way. He says, you know, if your parents had just been different, if you had married someone else, if you had stayed in school, if you hadn't made that big mistake and messed up like that, but now your future is blocked. That's what Satan wants to tell you. Now, Jacob still had the promise of God for his future, but in his present, he watched his brother Esau get the blessing and the honor of being firstborn. And Esau was clearly his father's favorite. So how could Jacob make it through the present into God's promised future? Well, Jacob made the same mistake a lot of people do. He looked at the situation, says, I better figure this out. And he tried to make it happen on his own. Jacob's problem was he assumed that God's blessing had to come through his father Isaac. And Isaac did not want to bless Jacob. Isaac wanted to bless Esau. And so Jacob decided to take matters into his own hands. And he decided to cheat and to manipulate to get the blessing that God had promised him. So Esau had the birthright by about 60 seconds. It was the double portion of the family inheritance. So Jacob tricked him out of it. And then Isaac was going to give Esau the blessing, but Jacob deceived his father and stole Esau's blessing for himself. But Jacob's deception did not help him. They only got him in a mess. The result of his trickery was his brother Esau hated him and wanted to kill him. And so to save his life, Jacob had to flee from home, go to a far land, live with his uncle Laban, never saw his father and mother again. What's even more interesting, he did not get the birthright anyhow. That birthright that he tricked his brother out of, he never got it. See, under the birthright things, Esau was supposed to get 2/3 of the family inheritance, and Jacob would get 1/3. But because he had to flee from home, Jacob never got any of it. Esau got it all. But see, God allowed that because he had to show Jacob that his prosperity came from God. And so God took him to Bethel. In Genesis 28, Jacob was fleeing from Esau, fleeing for his life. And he gets to Bethel and he lays down to sleep. And there he has a dream. And in his dream, he sees a stairway leading up to heaven. And the stairway was full of angels sent forth by God to minister to God's people. And up at the top of the stairs, he saw God himself keeping watch over the earth, sending angels on assignment. Why did God show him that? God was telling him, Jacob, I am here for you. I am your provider. I will send my angels to bring you what you need. God wanted Jacob to see that he did not have to worry and strive and manipulate in order to succeed. See, Jacob's future did not depend on Isaac. God was willing to bless him. But Jacob didn't get it. So Jacob went to Laban's, worked for Laban. He found out Laban was even more of a cheat than Jacob was. Laban cheated him over and over and over again. But the amazing thing was God blessed Jacob anyhow. No matter how Laban tried to cheat him, blessing overtook Jacob. Jacob ended up a wealthy man. What was God showing him? God was showing him the way to make it into your future is not through your own scheming and shrewdness and manipulation. Blessing comes from God. Tell your neighbor, blessing is from God. So Jacob had a God-given destiny. It was prophesied before he was born. He got messed up when he thought it was up to him to make it happen. But he finally learned that his future was in the hands of God. He finally connected past and future. He fulfilled his destiny and the world was changed. His offspring became the nation of Israel. One of his offspring was Jesus. And this year, in this year of connections, God wants you to see your past does not control your future. God controls your future. When blessing appears to be cut off, don't try to figure it out for yourself. Look to God. See, your provision does not depend on your family. Your provision does not depend on your boss. Your provision does not depend on how shrewd you can be. And it's not thwarted by the mistakes you have made. God can give you the power to redeem your past. He can give you a strategy to fulfill his promise for your future. And so the first example of connecting past promises with future fulfillment was Jacob. Jacob is sort of the example of what not to do. Avoid getting messed up. Don't try to figure it out on your own. The second example is a king named Josiah. Josiah became the king of Judah when he was only 8 years old. And he came into the kingdom at a very dark time. The northern kingdom of Israel had fallen into idolatry. They worshiped the golden calves, and because of their idolatry, God allowed them to be conquered by the Assyrians. Many of the people in the 10 northern tribes were carried off as captives. The Assyrians took the leaders, the warriors, the educated, the skilled artisans, and all that was left of the 10 northern tribes was a scattered remnant, the poorest of the poor, living among ruins. But see, the southern kingdom of Judah was not much better off. They had also turned to idols. Judgment had been prophesied against them also. But 300 years earlier, God had prophesied that Judah would have one last great revival. In 1 Kings 13, a prophet predicted, 300 years before Josiah was born, he predicted that a king named Josiah would be born to the house of David, who would destroy the idolatrous altars. And so in 2 Kings 22, after wicked King Ammon was assassinated, the people crowned his 8-year-old son, Josiah, king over Judah. And Josiah set his heart to follow the Lord. And when he was 16 years old, he gave orders that the temple be restored. And so Josiah, a 16-year-old king, led the nation in revival. Judah turns back to God. First of all, they restore the temple. They restore the sacrifices. And as they're restoring the temple, they found an old Torah scroll. Nobody had read Torah for probably a generation. But they found the Torah scroll and they began to read it and study it carefully. And as they read God's word, they realized how far they had come from what God intended for them. And so they humble themselves before God. They repent of their sins. They inquire of the Lord. They sought out Huldah, the prophetess. Isn't this interesting? One of the greatest revivals in Judah's history, led by a 16-year-old boy, directed by a woman prophet. But the nation responds. They remove all their idols. They celebrate God's redemption. They have a huge Passover feast. But Josiah's revival doesn't just affect the nation of Judah. The revival spreads. The first place it spreads to was Ephraim. 2 Chronicles 34 says, in the towns of Ephraim and the surrounding ruins, Judah tore down the altars and destroyed the idols. And the remnant of Ephraim turns back to God. Zechariah 10:7 pictures Ephraim as fully restored to the Lord and rejoicing before him. And the revival doesn't stop at Ephraim. It continues to spread up through the 10 northern tribes. It reaches as far as Zebulun and Naphtali in the far north. And again, Zebulun and Naphtali were a humbled remnant. Most had been carried off into captivity. They were living among ruins, but Josiah comes and he tears down the idols and they turn back to God. And see, that's why the 10 lost tribes were not really lost. By New Testament times, this region had a different name, but it was still the tribes of Zebulun and Naphtali. It was called Galilee. It was made up of Jews who were faithful to the true God. That's where most of Jesus' ministry took place. Nazareth, where he grew up, and Capernaum, the center of his ministry, were both in this region. When Jesus walked along the shore of the Sea of Galilee, calling Peter and James and John and preaching the good news and healing the sick, he was ministering to people whose ancestors had been touched by Josiah's revival. See, Josiah had a God-given destiny. It was prophesied 300 years before he was born. And Josiah connected the past with the future. He fulfilled his destiny, and the world was changed. How did Josiah do that? I mean, his father had been one of the most wicked of all the kings of Judah. He was living in a time when the people had forgotten the true God. But he did three things. First of all, he made a decision. He set his heart to seek the Lord. He said, I don't care what my dad was like. I don't care what other people want. I'm going to turn and follow the Lord. Secondly, he chose to read and obey the book. He said, I want to do what this says. And finally, he sought out the prophetic word. And as he did those things, his destiny opened. And see, that is always God's plan for connecting your past with your future. Seek the Lord with all your heart. Matthew 6:33 says, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and everything else will be added. Jeremiah said, you'll seek me and you'll find me when you seek me with all your heart. Secondly, you meditate on the word and you obey it. Psalm 1 says, if you will do that, you'll prosper in everything you do. Third, you seek out the prophets and you pay attention to what they say. 2 Chronicles 20:20 says, pay attention to the prophets and you will succeed. And so in this year of the Vav, if you want to connect your past to the future, if you want to make it through the present warfare into the fullness of your destiny, first of all, seek the Lord with all your heart. Ask God right now, Lord, what do I need to do this week to seek you? Secondly, meditate on the word. That means open up the book, read it, fill your mind with it, and obey it. Third, seek counsel from God's prophets and pay attention to them. By the way, for you on the web, doesn't mean everybody that calls themselves a prophet is really a prophet. Don't just run off and do something because somebody called themselves a prophet, but find out who the prophets are, who is reliable, and listen to what they say. And see, as you do that, that lets God connect your past and your future. And so the first two examples for connecting your past and your future are Jacob and Josiah, and the third example is Jesus. See, Jesus came to earth with an incredible destiny to fulfill. He was the Son of God and the promised Messiah, and he was sent to redeem mankind out of the hand of Satan. His coming had been prophesied for thousands of years. But you know, sometimes connecting the promises of the past with the glory of the future can take you down a hard path. Anybody ever been on a hard path? See, for Jesus, connecting the past and the future meant going to the cross. But Jesus set his face to go to the cross to redeem us from the curse, and he never looked back. Jesus had a God-given destiny, prophesied for thousands of years. It was not an easy path, but he walked it. Jesus connected the past to the future. He fulfilled his destiny and the world was changed. How did he do it? How did he make it through the battles of the present into the glory of the future? Well, Hebrews 12:2 says this, he did it for the joy set before him. See, when Jesus went to the cross, he was looking forward to your redemption. He was looking forward to you coming into the fullness of your identity and your destiny. He was looking forward to you fellowshipping with him through all eternity. And the joy of that thought was enough to drive him forward to endure the pain and the shame of the cross. And see, you have a God-given destiny. You were created for a purpose. You were created to be limitless for so much more than you have imagined. But the path to your future is not always easy. The book of Hebrews describes making it into your call and destiny like running a race. It says, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. That means he made it through. See, if God's path to your future leads you through some difficult places, God wants you to remember there's joy at the end of the path. Romans 8:18. And some of you are in a difficult place right now. You're saying, I don't know how I can press forward. But Romans 8:18 says, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. So when your path seems hard, God wants you to remember the best is yet ahead. Tell your neighbor, the best is yet ahead for you. And so in this year of the Vav, get ready to move forward in faith. Don't try to figure it all out. Don't try to make it happen. But seek the Lord with all your heart. Meditate on His word. Pay attention to His prophets and keep your eyes on the joy to come. This is a year to connect your past to the future and open the path to the promises of God. So let God establish your future this year. Let's stand up. Lord, I thank you that for each one here, for each one watching on the web, you have a future. You've given them a hope. You've created them for a purpose. There are people here, there are people on the web that if they can lay hold of who they really are and what they were created to be, the world will change. So Lord, right now, I release an anointing to connect the past to the future, to move forward in faith into the fullness of destiny. Lord, we thank you. We bless you. We honor you. In this tabernacle season, we receive your glory, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Now turn and pray a blessing around over someone near you. And you are dismissed.